Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Good morning, everyone. It's my great pleasure to welcome Jonathan Mayer from Stanford University. Jonathan is a PhD student there, and he's both a law school student as well as a computer science PhD student. So as we all know, online privacy is becoming ever more important, and there has been a do not track discussions all over the places, whether in academia, the standard bodies like W3C, as well as in various companies. Jonathan has been doing a lot of research in the do not track area, so we invited him to have him share with us about the work that he has done. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks for the kind introduction. So today's talk is going to be about a mile wide and a foot deep on the topic of do not track. There's a ton of material I want to cover. And so the MO I'd like to follow here is try to pack a lot into the discussion main, and then in the Q&A, we can kind of do a deep dive on specific topics of interest. So this was originally titled Technology, Policy, and Politics. A lobbyist for the online advertising industry suggested a title that I think is more accurate, so I'm going to do an on-the-fly rename. This Do Not Track Musings of a Graduate Student, which is a great segue, I think, into my obligatory disclaimer. These are, in fact, musings of a graduate student. Some people in the room I've interacted with a different hat on as a computer scientist at the California Department of Justice. I don't speak for the Department of Justice, and I don't speak for the Attorney General. Glad to have that out of the way, so none of that. Second, I want to get my thanks out of the way in advance. So all of this work is not just me. It's been a huge team at Stanford of advisors and colleagues and interns and various research institutions on campus. So I want to get the thanks out of the way up front. Okay, so that's it for introductory stuff. So some people have said some less than positive things about Do Not Track. I really liked when the supporters got called Naderites. Most of the people I know who work on this issue on a daily basis are not really old enough to have voted for Nader when it mattered. but whatever, it was kind of cool. And some people said some really nice things about Do Not Track. I really liked how USA Today just like couldn't help themselves and had to say Wild West Web. My hope at the end of this talk is you have an idea of why it is that there's a big debate here and some intuition around a bunch of the aspects of the debate. So the talk's going to proceed in four parts. First, I'm going to do a very quick history and review of the status quo of web tracking. So how we got to where we are and where we are. It's my understanding there's some differing experiences around the room, so I want to make sure to level the playing field. Second, I'm going to go into some detail on the technology used for third-party web tracking, the technologies that are available to consumers to get some choice over that tracking, and a little bit of discussion of technology for enforcing those choices. Then I'm going to move into policy. So I'm going to talk about how those choices might be architected and whether offering consumers those choices might have economic impact. And last, I'm going to give a very, very quick note on the political situation. So how likely is any of the stuff I'm talking about to actually happen? Okay, so that's the roadmap. I'm going to start with the history and status quo section. You may recall that in the ancient days of the web, a couple decades ago, there was this static website thing. Here's Tim Berners-Lee's original drawing of how the web would work. So it was a bunch of fixed documents, and you could link between. There would be links between the documents, and you could explore them. So 89 by 92, graphical websites, and that was the early static web. I promise the recap stuff is going to be done very quickly. That of course didn't last too long. All that was there was there was the ability to do. I guess you can kind of tell if there are web developers in the room if they laugh when you put those tags up on the screen. You may recall stuff that used to be able to like slide from side to side on a web page or like blink at you, and those tags got removed from HTML because they were just so obnoxious. Anyways, that was like the extent of interactivity and like active stuff on web pages. But right, that didn't last long. So 94, Netscape introduces cookies in web browsers. 95 introduces JavaScript. Of course, totally awesome features. Lets us store things like shopping carts in all sorts of other state. Lets us build whole applications in web browsers. But of course, introduces lots of possibilities for privacy concern. And so in 1997, the Internet Engineering Task Force, one of the large standards bodies for the internet, wrote a document saying, hey, web browsers, you really should look out for your users and make sure you protect them. Make sure they have good controls. And in practice, nothing really happened. It wasn't long after that the default in every shipping web browser was accept every cookie, run every piece of JavaScript. And if the user wanted to dig deep into their privacy preferences, they could make some exceptions. Not coincidentally, that very same year, DoubleClick was founded, the first behavioral advertising network, based on the recognition that you could use these technologies to follow people across different websites and learn about what their interests were and then target ads based on those interests. So that's it for the boring history stuff. So here's where we are today. So if you wake up in the morning, fire up your web browser, you might see something that looks like this. Or if you're conservative, it might look like this. Something for the lawyers in the audience. So we'll stick with the New York Times for simplicity. And it looks like the New York Times. It says the New York Times right up there in the banner. It's nytimes.com. It's got NY Times articles, images. It's got New York Times stock ticker and so on. But of course, it's not all the New York Times. In fact, lots of that content is not from the New York Times. There might be ads that aren't from the New York Times, images and video that are hosted by someone other than the New York Times, social content for sharing or using a single sign-on that's not from the New York Times. And then, of course, in addition to all of the things that are visible that might be from someone other than the New York Times, there are lots of content that might not be visible that's from someone other than the New York Times. So I want to give my favorite example of embedded third-party content on a website. So this is the UK's National Health Service page. Thankfully, no longer the case now. But for a while, they had the like button on their disease pages. And 5 people had liked syphilis. Yeah, for a long time, there was not a lot of control over the default there where all of your friends would look. So 5 people announced to all their friends that they're way into syphilis. Anyways. So here's the core privacy concern here. When you go to a page like the New York Times or many pages nowadays, there are now lots of companies that get tipped off about that visit. And those companies can, in essence, slap a barcode on your browser and scan that barcode on every page you go to. And then they're able to build up a sizable proportion of your web browsing history. So that's the core information at issue here. So in a study about a year and a half ago, the Wall Street Journal looked at popular websites. If I recall, it was about 50 of them. And they found that on average, there were 64 tracking mechanisms in place on these websites. And to recap, browsing history is the core of what's available here. That browsing history can either directly include or allow inference of health information, financial information, shopping history. It's a very rich data set and can include quite a lot. And no, this data is not necessarily anonymous. In fact, in many cases, it's not. Now, I'm going to take a quick moment to head-on tackle the claim that, well, it's all anonymous, so we don't have to worry about it. And this is a claim that you hear reiterated an awful lot in policy debates around third-party web tracking. In fact, there was a Time cover story where the author went and looked at what information was available about him from a bunch of third-party trackers and said, well, it doesn't have my name on it, and it doesn't seem to be all that accurate, so maybe I could be a little bit less concerned. And the first response I want to give on this it's all anonymous point is a super technically nitpicky response that actually it's all pseudonymous. But it turns out that really matters. So pseudonymous in the sense of there is an identifier, not the user's name, but some number, associated with this data across a bunch of sites. That number isn't the person's name, but it does allow linking across sites. So to give a rough graphical depiction of the implications for identity in web tracking, let's say that this is anonymity. Right, so I go talk to you on a website, and I learn your identity. Then I know who you are. in the context of that current transaction. But if you go walk away and come back, then I don't know who you are. And in fact, I don't know anything about you except you're just another user. Under pseudonymity, though, because you have the ability to link current interaction with past interaction and future interaction, then identifying once can actually identify in past and future. Right? So if I have a pseudonymous identifier for your web browsing history that I've been tracking all along, and in a current interaction, I get your identity, it's of course very trivial to associate that identity with things that have happened in past and things that are going to happen. Right? So that's a really important privacy property. Identify once, identify everywhere for all time. And it turns out, in fact, there are a bunch of ways in which identity can get associated with third-party web tracking data. In some cases, there's not even any debate. So we were talking earlier about Facebook, how one of the largest third-party trackers, by way of terminology, third parties are these entities that provide ads or other things on a page, not the page you're dealing with. First party is jargon for the site you're dealing with. The exact contours of what a first party and third party are getting hotly contested right now in the World Wide Web Consortium. Okay, so in some cases, the third party is a first party, for example, a social network that already knows your identity. So when Facebook provides the like button, they don't make any secret of the fact that they know who you are. In fact, they customize the like button saying, here are your friends who like this page. Here you can go comment on this page when they have a discussion widget. There are some cases of intentional leakage. So there are some companies that are in the business of getting users' identities and associating it with third-party web tracking data. So for example, there's a company called Datalogix. And their privacy policy, they actually do a very nice job of explaining their business model, which, as best I can tell, is they cut deals with e-commerce sites where they'll pay them in exchange for some identifying information. And then Datalogix will go to some offline data brokers and figure out what they can about the user. And then they'll bundle that data up and sell it on an online advertising exchange. There was recently some news coverage in the Wall Street Journal about how Visa and MasterCard are interested in being data providers for this ecosystem. So they don't want to be in the space of identifying users, but they're happy to provide data to companies that do identify users. There can also be unintentional leakage, so information is unintentionally sent from a first party to a third party that identifies a user. We'll get into that in just a second. There are some security exploits you could use. Last, there's this whole field of de-anonymization, this burgeoning area of academic research that shows that you can take a big mess of data that's pseudonymously identified and a big mess of data that actually is identified, and using statistical techniques, link the two up. And it turns out that it works incredibly well often. Okay, so I said I was going to reserve unintentional leakage. That's because we actually did a study quite recently on unintentional leakage, where we began with the Quantcast top 250 sites and found all the ones that we could sign up and interact with without whipping out my advisor's credit card. We also didn't test the sites that were like so large you could write a paper about them just themselves. So we didn't look at sites like Google or like Bing, where we didn't think we could do a reasonable job of testing. So that left us with 185 sites, and we found when we signed up and interacted with those sites and looked and used features that had to do with identity, that there was unintentional user ID and username leakage all over the place. So this is the most common recipients of username or user ID on the sites we tested. So Quantcast, for example, a large data provider and analytics service, on 34% of the sites we tested, got a username or user ID. Facebook, just to reiterate, quite large in the third-party tracking game. Even if they didn't already have a user's name from logging into Facebook, they're actually getting username or user ID on a bunch of sites themselves. So there are a lot of reasons users might be...
Just to understand.
Yeah.
Clarifying question. So you're saying for all the things on the left, they are obtaining the identity, user identity information from these many sites.
That's right.
81 sites. So Scorecard has got identity information from 81 sites. It's because those sites provide identity information to the Scorecard research?
Unintentionally.
So
we looked at...
Inquiry string and such?
Exactly. Right. So one of the most common ways identity would leak So site would have a user profile located to URL where that where the profile URL included the user's ID or username or sometimes their real name. It was also often the case that the landing page for a site would say something like, hi, your username or your real name. Many third-party scripts have the ability to read the title of a page. And so our methodology was very simple. We just looked at HTTP request URIs and refers and just did a built a regular set of regular expressions for different fields that might be of interest. We put together this fake biography. I've never been before so confident that, at least in the interpretation of some prosecutors, a research project I worked on violates federal law. But anyways, we signed up for a bunch of websites with this fake identity.
Is there any website that does not give away user identity among those apps?
Yes. So there are many. All of our data, we try to be totally open about it. You can download a spreadsheet of the results of running all of our regular expressions stuff.
What percentage of the websites does not give up?
I think it was about 40%. Right, so there are some sites that go out of their way to prevent sharing this information, but I think it's kind of a fact of life, at least for the near term, that there are so many sites that users log into that don't necessarily have the right incentives or might not have the engineering resources that this information is going to leak in some cases. And of course, because of this is pseudonymous, not anonymous, once one site leaks identity, then that identity is available past, present, and future. Yeah?
So for those 40 whatever percentage of sites that you said they don't leak or inadvertently leak users' ID to those third-party analytics servers, they still may, right? Because your test is kind of dynamic testing. You just did some interaction. You didn't cover all the possible things that might happen, right?
For sure. There are a lot of limits to the methodology we used here. There's a whole laundry list of caveats. The research is at cyberlaw.stanford.edu. It's in a blog post. There's an extensive list of caveats. And yes, this is not necessarily representative of user interaction. It might be over-inclusive or under-inclusive of some interactions. Totally right. Yeah?
Did you spend any time looking at the recipients of the unintentionally spilled data and whether or not they either use the information, or I realize it's hard to tell that, or specifically did the opposite, like took measures not to use information that may have been spilled to them?
So we do web measurement work using this tool I'm going to briefly discuss in a little bit. It doesn't give us insight into what companies do once they receive data. I think it is very reasonable to assume that the majority of recipients of this data did not use it to identify users. I think it's also reasonable to assume that a lot of the companies that received this data took steps to try to make sure that they didn't actually save user IDs or usernames anywhere. That said, I think for policy purposes, there is a very big difference between an online privacy problem where it's all anonymous and an online privacy problem that's has identity all over the place and companies promise that they're going to try to anonymize data. So that was the distinction we wanted to point out. But there are, of course, companies that are explicitly in the business, like Datalogix and others, that do go out of their way to try to identify users. Whether they use unintentional leakage to try to identify users, I'm not sure. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say about identity and tracking. To close up this section on where we are, just want to note there are a lot of reasons why users might be concerned about third-party web tracking, both the collection of this data and its use in profiling users and displaying ads or possibly making choices about offers that are available or possible future uses. So there are a lot of potential concerns here. There is some polling data to suggest that a lot of users really don't like this. There is a poll done by researchers at UPenn in 2009. Over 80% of respondents thought that these practices should be just illegal. And over 90% thought that if they opted out, that opt-out should be legally binding.
Yeah, but that study is a study where they didn't say that there would be any consequences to making this the case.
That's exactly right. So this is a response that many have to the UPenn study. It would be great to see some rigorous study of what exactly the trade-off users are going to make is. Designing studies that get at that are really, really hard, because it turns out that how you frame the question, like, for example, whether you say you're going to pay this much or you'll receive this much, whether you, how you describe the value the user is going to receive and how they're going to pay it, all these framing effects actually matter a huge amount in how consumers respond. And so the proposal I'm going to be getting at is less one of users should be able to opt out and get all of this stuff for free, but rather one of if a user opts out, then we're just going to flip the coin and a company can say, I will offer you, you know, you can still get this, but I'm going to charge you a certain amount. Or you can just turn off this opt-out, right? So, if we want to get at the question of how much does a user want to pay, or would a user be willing to pay in exchange for not being tracked, right? To kind of, if there's economic value to being tracked, compensate the publisher, the first-party website, for not having tracking-based advertising, then let's provide a means of getting at that value exchange. And if a user decides they don't like the terms of that value exchange, then they can say, you know what, fine, go ahead and track me. Or they can walk away. So we're just surfacing that economic debate. You're absolutely right that if the question were, would you pay $2 a month to use the New York Times instead of getting it for free? If it costs $2 to not have behavioral tracking used to target ads or some other restriction, I would imagine that there would be a large proportion of users would say, I'm okay with it then. But we just want to surface that choice.
The user would be okay with pay or?
So the types of options that we're imagining would arise, I mean, get into do not track in not too long, would be any sort of option the company wants to provide. So that you know, you could say, I'm going to offer you the same service, even though you're a do not track user. You could say, I'm going to charge you. You could say, I'm going to require you to sign up for a subscription with one of my affiliate companies. You could say, I'm just not going to serve you. Or you could say, I need you to turn off do not track. Right, so that there's a whole range of options from what happens when a user is turned on do not track and visits a site. So it's the start of a conversation. It's not really the end of it as we envision it. Did you have a question?
Yeah, well, first comment, I mean, this should be viewed for the footnote of that most users do not understand what tracking means. I mean, there's been numerous CV studies which have shown that people are dramatically confused about what it really is doing.
Yeah, so there are a bunch of studies that have tried to get at this question while making sure that the people they're interviewing actually understand what they're responding about. I thought the UPenn guys did a pretty good job. They have a nice description, it's about 10 pages of how they set up their methodology. There are other studies. It seems to be a pretty robust result that it's a majority of people, at least, in some form of the question of would you like to opt out, say yes. But
for the purposes of this conversation, could you give us your definition of tracking?
I'm going to get there.
Okay, great.
Yes.
You might want to take this question later, but I thought I'd just ask you. So, in a book called The Internet Bubble, Filter Bubble, Eli Parsier basically has a very strong criticism about your proposal in the last chapter. I don't know if you have read about it.
I have.
At some point, I would like you to just... basically, his claim is that do not track does not work because that is economic reality. What you really need to go to do is look at the principles of privacy and make sure that people understand when their privacy is violated, because in real life, when my privacy gets violated, I have a feedback mechanism. Like if I'm shouting now, I know that these people can hear me. In internet, it is a one-way traffic because I have no way of understanding what these people do. So that is, seems to be his most important criticism about do not track as a notion.
So maybe can we hold that until the end and re-ask that very question?
Sure.
Okay. All right. So that was it for the history and status quo stuff. So now I'm going to move into the technical discussion. So the first part of the technical discussion I want to get into is how tracking technology works. And broadly speaking, there are two kinds of tracking technologies. There are those that require putting some sort of state in the browser, so slap some sort of barcode on the browser, and those that don't require any sort of state in the browser. They rely on features that you can learn about the browser or any other device without storing state. In the jargon of the debate, a lot of people call stateful tracking tagging or some forms of tagging super cookies. So kind of anything that is tagging and is not cookies kind of de facto becomes a super cookie. Go figure. And then anything that's stateless tends to be called fingerprinting. Those are rough definitions. Sometimes people have other things in mind, but I think it's just for convenience in this talk, I'm going to use them. So there are a bunch of ways in which you can do state. Yeah?
I'm trying to understand what stateless tracking is. Stateless on servers, but it's...
Stateless on the client.
Stateless on the client.
Yeah, I'm going to get into it.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so there are a bunch of stateful tracking technologies that you can use, ranging from the most simple, you know, HTTP cookies we've had for quite a long time now, to all sorts of stuff that, of course, was never intended to be used to track a user, but it turns out you can use to track a user. So, for example, HTTP strict transport security. This is a setting a web browser can send to, a web server can send to a browser saying, hey, please... please only connect to me over a secure connection. It turns out that encodes some state, and you could actually encode an identifier using that state. And so there are all of these different approaches. Many of them are starting to get used in practice. Over the summer, my team worked with a team at Berkeley looking at the practices of a company called Kissmetrics, an analytics provider. They were using the technologies that are in the red boxes. They were, in fact, using some of these technologies to bring back HTTP cookies that had been deleted. Those are so-called zombie cookies in the debate. There's a very colorful debate terminology.
What
yeah?
DNS cache? I mean, how does a DNS cache use for identity tracking?
So this one is actually a little bit more theoretical than the others right now. But you could imagine trying to encode some information that uniquely identifies a user or a device into the DNS cache.
The request will come to you more quickly if it's in DNS cache.
But how does a client get tracked? I still don't get that. Like my browser asks some DNS, which is, I'm presuming, is not into the tracking business. I ask him for the IP address of name. He gives me the name. I take the name and go there. The user, like google.com or microsoft.com, does not know that I asked for their name to the DNS. So how does that play?
So the general approach for all of these technologies would be try to encode some information into it. So it's not about sharing information between companies.
So this is the side channels is well known to have ways of these basic.
No, I understand most of these other things.
We should probably move on for
okay.
the purpose of this talk.
People have been thinking particularly about CNAMEs. That's, I think, the place in DNS state where there's been some recent attention. Not clear if it'll work. It's a little theoretical. Okay. Over the summer, we looked at a script that Microsoft hosted on some of its pages that may have unintentionally used these two mechanisms to persist a user identifier. And we also, over the summer, looked at a company called Epic Marketplace. I don't know why you call your company Epic, but whatever. That used browsing history in this case, not identify a user, but to recover parts of the browsing history. I just want to go very briefly into some level of technical detail on this one, just to give a flavor of how sneaky you can be in recovering browsing history data or just encoding data into the browser. So you may recall that in the old days of the web, if you hadn't clicked a link, it was blue. You never know how good a projector is going to be, so I figured I'd just go ahead and put that there. And if you had clicked a link, of course, it was purple. And so the way this browser history approach works is by loading a bunch of invisible links and just asking, are they blue or purple? And you can then tell if the user has visited that link. Now, this is a security vulnerability that's been patched in all of the newest web browsers, including Internet Explorer. But there are, of course, a lot of old web browsers that are still vulnerable. About half of web browsers that are out there as of when we looked this summer. And this company was testing about a little over 15,000 URLs, including stuff on the NIH website, stuff on the Mayo Clinic website, and the FTC website, on the IRS website, looking for information about whether a user was trying to get pregnant or was entering menopause, or whether a user had bad credit or back taxes. So that's the kind of stuff that's actually in the wild. So that's it for stateful tracking technologies. So now to get into a quick discussion of fingerprinting technologies. So the idea is there are all these features that might arise from a device that individually seem just kind of innocuous and are in fact totally useful. but taken in the aggregate actually wind up being very identifying for that device, pseudonymously identifying, I should say. And so it turns out that you can do a really good job of tracking web browsers just using these features. There's a great study by Peter Eckersley at the EFF where a bunch of users volunteered to have this information and more taken from their web browser and see how uniquely identifying it was. And it turned out in many cases it was uniquely identifying. And in fact, there are a bunch of companies that are now in the business of using this information to pseudonymously identify users. In fact, by my very casual count, yesterday, there are about 3 new fingerprinting companies founded in the past 2 months. So this is an area where there's increasing recognition that this technology works. It works really well. In fact, it works better than just setting plain HTTP cookies. And so there's a lot of business interest.
So is there any way to prevent this? Because the other techniques were executing a JavaScript you get from NoScript or Ghostly and stuff like that, prevent it. Is there a way to defend against fingerprinting?
And the argument I'm about to make on this slide is no. The very technologies that make the web totally awesome, that let us do all of that great stuff ranging from preserving state to providing security in the connection between the browser and the server to making sure that videos can buffer flash storage or Silverlight storage and so on, all that stuff that's totally great and it makes complete sense for making the web awesome, also allows privacy invasions. And it's those very same technologies that we want to have that enable third parties to track users across websites. And it doesn't seem, at least to us, that there is any way of narrowly carving out the privacy problems that come from those technologies, while at the same time preserving all of the great functionality that we want to give to users. That's why when you start to talk about anti-tracking technologies, it tends to less be about shutting down specific features, and the debate seems to more be moving in the general direction of let's just see how we can block stuff. Because at the point at which someone can run a script in a browser, they can fingerprint it. At the point at which someone has access to some storage in the browser, they can then go ahead and encode some state into that storage. And increasingly, it seems that these places where you could fingerprint or you could use storage are getting used. And so there are a bunch of technologies offered in the blocking space. Microsoft has a feature in Internet Explorer 9, tracking protection lists, which are a blocking feature. And blocking definitely has its place. There are a lot of good things about blocking. It's provable in the sense that if you don't load something from a website, then they're not going to be able to do things to your browser. So that's a benefit. But there are some issues with blocking. Just to give a quick flavor of what blocking looks like, so this is an actual block list. So there's this whole list of URLs and regular expressions for what to load or what not to load. And this is often been called a cat and mouse game or arms race between the guys who write these lists and the folks who are in the business of tracking who will offer some new service, and then the list has to go catch up. So there's some good things about blocking in provability. But there are some things that are not so great about blocking. First, block lists are not comprehensive. So your protection is only coextensive with what's on the list. And in fact, lists might not just have rules about what to block. They might also have rules about what to allow. So not only is a list not comprehensive, but it might actually, depending on the implementation, override other lists or other technologies and allow the user to be tracked. This was a problem early, I think it was about the spring, when Trusty offered a list for Internet Explorer that would override other tracking protection lists in Internet Explorer 9 and allow companies that were clients of Trusty to be tracked. It's just kind of ridiculous.
Intended for a brief period of time because they were giving their members the opportunity to demonstrate they were doing the right things. And then they updated the list, and I believe they don't do that anymore. They don't have the giant override, but I haven't checked it myself, so I don't know.
I can't speak to right now, but I can say that as of at least a few months ago, it was still a giant override list. There were still a lot of block things. Yeah, I'm going to get into the data on that in just a second. Lists aren't comprehensive. Lists have to get updated. So whoever's maintaining the list has to make sure that they're keeping up with whatever the latest tracking technologies and providers are. And of course, the browser or whatever is managing the list or tool has to make sure that its definitions get updated. There's another problem where blocking breaks stuff. So if you want to prevent, for example, Microsoft's Atlas advertising network from tracking you, under a blocking approach, at least for now, what that means is you're going to block ads from the Atlas ad network. And that's, in fact, what a lot of these tools do. And that seems like just a really bad outcome for everyone. So likewise, if you wanted to block the Facebook like button, that would mean getting rid of from tracking you. That would mean blocking the Facebook like button. And as my colleague Arvind Narayanan once put it, any solution that breaks the Facebook like button is no solution at all. At any rate, okay. And the last piece that I think is really an issue, Arvind Narayanan, he's a postdoc at Stanford. And the last major concern I have about blocking approaches is that they require users to actually go and learn stuff about this space. That you have to actually know about the providers of these lists or other blocking tools, and you have to choose correctly among them. And I think it's going to be it's really difficult for users to make a call about which list to trust. So here's some of the descriptions of lists and a tool that we saw. So blocks many technologies that can track and profile you as you browse the web. It actually turned out that one hadn't been updated in a few months, as I understood it. Completely removes all forms of tracking from the internet. Complete control over online tracking and so on. So it's difficult to believe that users are going to be able to sort this one out in the slightest. Sorry, what's that?
It's a small I internet.
It's not the one Al Gore invented.
So we did this quick study where we went and crawled the Alexa 500 a few times with each of these tools installed and looked at some rough aggregate metrics of how these tools seem to perform. So we had three metrics. We looked at how many of the pages a third-party domain, we use public suffix plus one, received an HTTP request on, how many it sent a set cookie response header on, and then we use this cookies added minus deleted metric as a very rough approximation for measuring cookies that actually got set in the browser. So some tools depended on stripping out headers at a later stage after we intercepted whether the response header got sent, or preventing cookies from getting set through JavaScript. So that's what that third one is. It's actually a really noisy measurement, so I wouldn't rely on the green bars too much. But the key takeaway here is that there's huge variability in what's going on. So here you can see that Abin, before we called it to their attention, their list was not really doing a lot. Trustee's list, right. I think it just kind of goes without saying what's going on there. And again, at the time we tested it, had a lot of allow rules, many more allow rules than block rules, so rules that would override other lists to allow companies to track. The other takeaway we had of list performance was that there really didn't seem to be a lot of correlation between how well branded a list was and how well it performed. It turned out the top performer was by these guys, the Fanboys list, which is this like anarchist collective in New Zealand represented by a dude wearing a gas mask. As against names that are trying to become brands in privacy, Trustee and Abin, Privacy Choice, Ghostery offered by Evidon. They're an advertising, a company in the advertising space. It's again difficult to believe customers are going to get it. Note that the lists that are the top performers are actually combinations of lists. So you actually have to install two or even three lists to get to the highest effectiveness we saw. So not only do the customers have to figure out who to trust and who not to trust, but the user then has to figure out which combination of things from them to install. And I think in the end, it's just not reasonable to expect users to do that. I don't think you should need a PhD from Stanford and a lab full of interns running web crawls to figure out what tool to install to protect your privacy. So that was the first tool for controlling privacy. The second one I want to talk about is opt-out cookies. So most prominently offered by the NAI There's a duel to the NAI, the Digital Advertising Alliance. I'm not going to go overly into the like organizational dynamics of all of this. If you're involved in the space, everywhere I say NAI, I think it's okay to substitute DAA too. I don't think I'm saying anything that gets at the institutional divides between the two. The DAA is kind of a superset of the NAI now. So the NAI is this this coalition of about 70 companies that offer a cookie-based opt-out tool. So the technology is very simple. You go to their website and you say, I would like to opt out. And then a cookie for each of the member companies gets set, saying the user's opted out. And so when the browser goes and communicates with those companies, they can read that cookie and note that the user's opted out. So technically, very simple tool. There are a lot of technical problems with this tool, though. First, again, not comprehensive. There are many companies in the third-party tracking business that don't participate in NAI or DAA. There's, again, the need to update these. So, if a company joins NAI or DAA, then you have to make sure you have go back and install their cookies. Your cookies can expire, so you want to make sure that they stay in place. There was a FTC enforcement action against a company about a year ago, I think-ish, called Tritica that had a cookie that expired after about 10 days. They've since fixed the issue. And I believe all the NAI members have now set about a five-year period for cookies to expire. So if you have your computer for over 5 years anyways, then you're going to have to update. And last, there's this problem of accidental clearing. So something that users often do to protect their privacy, or something like a virus scanner will do for them, is clear cookies that look kind of suspicious, or just clear all their cookies. And of course, if you clear all your cookies, and some of those cookies are opt-out cookies, then you've just blown away your opt-out. And so there's an asterisk next to those last two, because there are some browser extensions that solve those problems. There's one called Taco. There's Google's Keep My Opt-Outs and others that'll just make sure those cookies stay in place. And the extension will update with newer members. So I don't think asking users to install an extension is, in fact, a really great approach to privacy. In fact, I think Microsoft did a great job by baking privacy into IE9 instead of explicitly designing against going with an extension approach and instead building things into the browser. I think that recognition is totally correct, that being in browser is very different from living in extension land. Okay, so there's kind of a corollary to all of the self-regulatory cookie technology. There's this notice system that gets provided to users. This comes out of the DAA, so that duel of NAI. And you might notice this in some ads. So there's an icon that looks like this, and then some text next to that icon. Originally, it was proposed that this would be a pretty sizable thing, kind of right at the top of ads. User could click it, and they get taken to an opt-out pitch. That's not actually how it evolved in practice. First, there is a lot of concern about real estate in ads. So a lot of times the text would not appear. You'd just get the icon. And then there are further concerns about real estate, such that putting in a big icon would be take away way too much from display ad real estate. So instead, let's shrink the icon. So in the end, we wind up with an icon that's about in the ballpark of 15 by 15 pixels. That when you click it, takes you to a landing page that's not actually an opt-out page. It's a page that describes how the current ad was targeted to you. Some companies are responsible, and that page will also provide an opt-out link. Some companies, I think, are less responsible, and that page is more or less just their privacy policy.
Could you give examples of that?
Of companies that land you in the privacy policy?
No, the companies that you click on the link and take you to a page where there's no opt-out at all.
I don't know off the top of my head. After the talk, I'd be happy to chat about it. I have a spreadsheet of the URLs that we got to when we clicked, so we could go look. So this is kind of the final state of the advertising, so-called advertising option icon. And then setting aside that, like, there's this idea of let's essentially put a graphical privacy policy in ads, knowing that users don't read privacy policies on websites anyways. But that'll solve third-party web tracking. Setting aside that, it turns out it doesn't even show up that often. So we did this study where we went and manually labeled the third-party display ads on the Alexa top 500 sites. There are things you can't unsee in the Alexa top 500, it turns out. No one's run a web crawl before? Okay. It's awful. Anyways, so 10% of the ads we saw had the icon, and only 5% had the icon with even the ad choices text next to it. So it really didn't show up that much.
Can you do a filter on AI members or DAA members to see if those companies were actually participating in this program?
No. We did not try to figure out where each ad was sourced from.
So they all U.S.?
We reported results for both U.S. sites and all sites in the Alexa International Top 500. The numbers moved up a little bit if you cabin just for U.S. sites. I think it wound up being like 10.5% of ads, something like that, but not a lot. And in fact, many of the non-U.S. sites use U.S.-based advertising networks to provide their ad content. I recognize this is all like very shallow dive on the contents of the studies. Happy to answer stuff in Q&A. And also, if you want to read our full write-ups themselves, all on cyberlaw.stanford.edu. So much more about our methodology and all of our data for all of the things that I point to that are study-like. Okay.
But why would advertisers want to participate in an AI at the first place?
So that's a great question. I think it's a real problem. I think there's a real misalignment of incentives here. The companies that are now tasked with providing users with notice and choice about third-party web tracking are the very companies that have all of the economic incentives to get users to not actually exercise that choice. And I think that's what we're seeing play out right here. And Bruce Schneier once coined the term security theater as like things that are supposed to make you feel secure but don't actually provide security for users. I think this is privacy theater. Like I think this is stuff that's supposed to convince regulators and legislators that there's an industry that is providing consumers with real notice and choice. I mean, on the Hill a week or two ago, right, there was a blown up version of that big icon shown to a House subcommittee. Like, that's not something that is directed to users, that's something that's directed to legislators. But setting aside all of those technical problems, I'm gonna cheat a little bit and sneak a little policy into this section. Setting aside all of those technical problems, there's kind of this dirty little secret of opt-out cookies that as defined under NAI and DAA guidelines, opt-out cookies actually aren't about opting users out of tracking. They're about opting users out of ad targeting. I'm gonna get more precise in definition of tracking in a little bit. As their position, they're described over and over again as opt-out cookies providing consumer choice, positioned in the context of online privacy debates. I used to try to like very carefully hedge my words and say like, you know, it borders on a little bit kind of sketchy or slightly deceives, and I can't do that anymore. I think this entire system is totally deceptive. Whether it's intended to be or not, at the point at which like people in government and users are routinely concerned about what these opt-out cookies actually promise to do, and there's recognition that users are and these other stakeholders are totally concerned about what these cookies promise to do, then whether or not your intent originally was to mislead, at this point, like there's a problem. And there needs to be a lot more clarity about what these cookies actually do. We did a study towards the beginning of the summer where we tried to get a rough bound on what happens when you install these opt-out cookies in your browser, which companies seem to be blowing away their tracking cookies. And it looked like about half of the participants in the NII that we studied weren't blowing away their tracking cookies when you opted out. So they were actually taking advantage of this fact that it's not do not target ads. They were actually continuing to track users after they'd affirmatively opted out. And that got a lot of press attention. We were kind of surprised by the whole thing, because it was kind of conventional wisdom in people who studied this space that about half of companies would still do this after opting out. In fact, there was a study by Carnegie Mellon looking at privacy policies of companies, and they ballparked about 50% of the companies they looked at in the NAI seemed to be reserving the right to track after opt-out. But nonetheless, there was this kind of like great public outcry over, wait, what? There's tracking after opt-out? And at the point at which that's the reaction, like people don't understand this system. So I think it's deceptive. And in fact, it's so deceptive that it's not just users and legislators and regulators that get misled. It's sometimes even the companies or their employees that get misled that are in this space. So here's the announcement for Keep My Opt-Outs, which is the tool that Google offers to keep your tracking cookies in place. So that's the way they described it. I think they've since changed this language. I'm not sure. But there's actually language like this all over privacy policies for companies that participate in NAI, where they'll say, you can go to this page to do blank, where blank is not opt out of having ads targeted to you based on tracking. But in fact, they actually make some claim about being able to opt out of tracking itself. So I'm going to skip the remainder of my bashing on self-regulation, because I think the point is taken, and move on to do not track. Okay, so do not track is this third way that we think has a lot of the advantages of a blocking system in providing more rigorous controls over privacy, and a lot of the advantages of a cookie system in not requiring users to make a lot of choices and being a somewhat easier to integrate tool with existing web technologies. So here are the design principles we started with when we started to think about how we could build a do not track system. We were definitely not the first to think about how you could do a do not track thing, by the way, nor were we the first to position this specific approach to do not track. So when we started thinking about it last August, we said we want a system that's universal, no updating on the client, and one click. So if I care about not being tracked by third parties on the web, then it's one click in my browser preferences and the privacy pane, and I'm done. And it seemed to us that the really simple way of doing this was just adding an HTTP header. So not dissimilar to the opt-out cookie approach, except one standardized header that would get set in the browser, so it didn't rely on cookies persisting, and that could get sent to all third parties the browser communicated with. So that's what it looks like. That is the sum total of what you need to do to get a PhD at Stanford these days. And a bunch of web browsers have implemented support for it, including Microsoft's. Google is the last holdout, and I think a lot of people razz them at every opportunity about it. And a lot of people are using this now, actually. By last metrics from Firefox, at least, it looked like over 10 million people were sending Do Not Track right now. Compare that to the number of users who are using opt-out cookies, it's about 100 times greater. Right, so this is a system that's like in the proposal stage, a system that some web browsers have implemented. Only about a dozen companies have pledged to support in some way right now, and yet it's already seeing orders of magnitude greater adoption. And so I think that kind of further reaffirms, at least to us, that that the opt-out system as it exists is more of a privacy theater, and that this approach actually does a better job of putting users in the driver's seat. This is all it takes to recognize a do not track header in PHP. So to the extent there is, you know, any concern that this is difficult to at least interpret the header, not making any claims about how difficult it is to implement the business logic of protecting user privacy, that's pretty straightforward. So just a little bit of PHP there. Yeah?
Quick question. How can we tell if the server side is respecting this header or not? I mean, I say do not track it, but who knows? Can we tell?
I'm so glad you asked. So let's talk about enforcement. Okay. So there, broadly speaking, two ways in which you could enforce do not track. One way is observing suspicious behavior. So you could send a browser out and see what happens, or crowdsource data about what happens to browsers, and see if it looks like any of these stateful or stateless tracking technologies are getting used on the browser, even though the user sent do not track. And the second broad approach, that's a little bit more theoretical at this point, not really clear if it would work, you could look at ad distribution. So you could at least try to get some bounds on, does it look like these are ads that are getting customized based on my browsing history or not? So you could try to detect, if you will, collection from the browser, and you could try to detect advertising use. Of course, not all use is advertising, but those are broadly speaking the two buckets in which you could try to enforce. We've built this tool that we're hoping over time will evolve into a really comprehensive solution for the first of these. It's called Fourth Party. You can read about it, download the source, play with it, fourthparty.info. That's how we've run all of the studies I've highlighted. It instruments just about every API we could get our hands on in Firefox, such that we're able to ask, you know, who seems to be asking an awful lot in JavaScript about the computed style of link elements. And it turned out there's this one company asking, like, hey, are these 15,000 links styled in this one way? So we followed up on that. Unsurprisingly, they were doing history stealing. That's the sort of approach we've taken so far. We're looking forward to automating it and moving this into the cloud and making it less of a researcher-specific tool and more of a user-facing tool. Yes?
Ask whether now or later if you could share a link or any other figures on the uptake of DMT. That was interesting. I hadn't seen anything really public yet. So
there were some numbers reported out of Mozilla. There were some numbers out of, I think it was Crux Digital.
Okay. Those are all publicly.
Yeah, everything I'm saying here is totally public.
Okay.
I would be happy to follow up with links. Okay, cool. Okay, so I recognize we're getting a little crunched on time. Okay, so then maybe I'll just keep moving and we'll keep doing this format of asking questions throughout and then at the end, a little. Okay. So that's all I wanted to say about technology and a lot more than I initially intended to say about technology. Now the policy section. So this gets into the meat of someone asked earlier, what does do not track mean? What is this tracking thing? So I'm going to get into that, and then I'm going to say a very little bit about economics. So you may have noticed that by defining this do not track header, we've now just punted the entire problem of third-party web tracking to what has to happen when someone receives this header, right? So we have a technical means of conveying a user preference. We have some technical means of enforcing some forms of preferences, but we have to figure out what that preference actually is. So the first pass I want to make here is that there are some companies that seem to have decided to run with the talking point that I don't know what do not track means. In fact, this is as best I can tell, a very popular Google talking point. There's that old rule of thumb, like here at once, it's one person's opinion twice, maybe some people in the company think it three times at public events, it's a talking point. So here are three public events where someone at Google said, we don't know what do not track means. I don't think that's an accurate description of where the do not track debate stands. I, in fact, think there's really broad consensus about what do not track means. I want to be careful that when I say broad consensus, I am referring to stakeholders in the NGO space, in the academic space, some stakeholders coming from the Federal Trade Commission. I'm not claiming that what I'm about to say is consensus among people in industry, nor do I want to say that it's perfect consensus. In fact, there are certainly some differences of agreement, differences of opinion in some of the specifics. But at a high level, I think there actually is a lot of agreement between all of these organizations. Yes?
A separate group. I mean, so industry, I assume you mean the advertising industry?
Yes.
Are there entities which you think are representative of sort of publishers as a group and their opinion and the stake in the debate?
Sorry, I should have just said first. Industry, companies in the business of third-party tracking, that actually cuts across a bunch of industries. Right, if you were to ask social networks, they also would not agree with what I'm about to say. Publishers have largely not been at the table. Which I think is a loss for publishers. They have a very different viewpoint on all of these. Some see their data as something that they want to carefully retain. Some want to be sure that they don't put their users at risk. Some see this as a monetization issue. So they say, if we can control our data, that gives us more ability to monetize our site. I think many publishers would come at this with a very different set of incentives from where companies that are in the third-party tracking space come at it from. I don't necessarily think they're perfectly aligned with all of these groups, but it's a totally fair point that they're not adequately represented at the table. I can say that, like, from our lab, we've tried to bring publishers into discussions about do not track, there's definitely been interest in it, but not so far really a high level of engagement. The forum where many of the discussions that are going on are in Do Not Track or W3C, there's some people in this room who are participating in the W3C process and know just how fun it is. The W3C is this web standards body, and they now have a working group set up to define what Do Not Track means. Here's what I think there is increasingly a significant degree of consensus about in Do Not Track. That when we're talking about the privacy concern here, we're largely talking about user expectations. That when users go use the New York Times, they don't expect necessarily to go give information about the articles they read to Google or to Facebook and so on. And so coming from that place of we're concerned about user expectations, you have to define third-party tracking. And we see the way of doing that is just splitting apart the terms. So you have to define what a third party is, and you have to define what tracking is. And the W3C seems to be going in this approach. Okay, so to begin, what's a third party? The first observation I want to make is that third party is a role, not an entity. So you could have a company that's a third party in some interaction and a first party in another. So like Facebook is a first party when you use Facebook.com. It's a third party when you use the like button. Second, you can't have a technical bright line here. So Amazon, for example, hosts a lot of content off of AmazonAWS.com. That's where they offer some of their cloud infrastructure. I think that, and all of the content hosted off AmazonAWS.com, the pages at least, are branded as Amazon. The site's totally controlled by Amazon. And so though these are different domain names, I think if you were on Amazon.com, stuff hosted from AmazonAWS.com, pretty clearly, by user expectation standards, would still be Amazon. And likewise, AmazonAWS.com going to Amazon. And then there's this other problem of websites that look like they should just be a first party and seem pretty innocuous that might actually be considered a third party. So for example, everyone knows Apple.com. Here's metrics.apple.com. And it turns out that metrics.apple.com is actually C-named over to Adobe. So it's not an Apple server you're talking to when you're talking to metrics.apple.com. You're talking to an Adobe Omniture analytics server. Without passing on the question of how analytics should be treated by Do Not Track, which is a whole other debate that I'm not even going to start to get into today, I think it is sufficient to say that that doesn't quite align with user expectations in the way that, say, the Amazon example does. Yeah, you had a question?
It's the right time to ask an answer out. If you want to delay it, feel free to. You were saying that I'm reading New York Times, so I have a like button. I don't want Facebook to know I'm reading this New York Times article. But it's unclear to me with your suggestion of DNT with one for everything I'm go to, and for the people who's really into social network, I really want to know my friends read this article or not, and I have to sign in and tell Facebook I'm reading it, how many of my friends are liking it. I don't see how these two can fit together. Does it make sense?
It does. So the way this question has been framed in the context of the Do Not Track debate has largely been one of opting back in. So the idea has been, instead of giving users a kind of long list of companies they might choose to trust or not trust, or setting some sort of complex policy like P3P did about a decade ago, instead, let's give users one choice. And then the incentives are aligned such that the company that wants to convince a user to make an exception for them is the one that's in the position to provide the best user interface for the user to make that exception for them. So on our website, donottrack.us, we have this thing called the Do Not Track Cookbook, which provides some code examples and some policy discussion of how you might implement opting back in. And we give this example of exactly that, the Facebook like button, and how Facebook could trivially add a little line to the like button that says, hey, turn on personalized social sharing. If you do, then you'll be able to see stuff your friends like. Right?
So do you think that every third-party widget on a website should add a line to their own widget that says opt back in versus just clicking on the like button?
So I think it's going to vary a lot by what sort of widget it is. So I think there are going to be some sorts of widgets that come from, if you will, one-off trusted companies like Facebook, where a user might just say one click, I'm a Facebook user, and yeah, I really like to be able to see what my friends like, or I really like to be able to comment as myself on this page, so I'm going to grant Facebook an exception to my Do Not Track preference. I think there are going to be some companies where that's a harder model. So companies in the advertising network space, I think it's very unlikely that a user is going to grant specific exceptions for, AppNexus, for example, and their platform. Incidentally, I would note that, like, this very argument is kind of the duel of why the current advertising option icon doesn't work so well. These kind of fine-grained company-by-company choices, like just-in-time notice, and then the user gets to choose, in the broad case of online advertising, has not really worked well. And I completely agree that it's not reasonable to think it's going to work well in a do-not-track world. And so I think there are two possible follow-ons from that. The first is there's a space for various forms of intermediaries. So, for example, I don't want to say trusty, but something in the same kind of model as trusty that's, you know, here's some voluntary commitment these companies have made about data retention or so on, so go ahead and allow these 12 companies to continue tracking me. There's no reason that wouldn't be doable. And in fact, I think that would be a good outcome. But the...
Know more about me, and it's really hard to control how these companies sell my information to other parties, like Facebook, right? All the app policy control is really hard to configure correctly. Then now Google become all these big players knows everything, and they make a mess about how I control who can get my information. For example, credit card companies now trying to sell my transaction records to improve targeting ads, right? So I'm not sure if that's a good outcome.
So I think the first thing I would note is I think it's no worse than the status quo, where it's kind of, well, as the USA Today put it, the Wild West web. The second thing is I think there's a lot of value in now companies have to have the incentive to give a pitch to consumers about why you should allow them to track you. And so a company like Microsoft that has a positive track record on privacy is, of course, in a much better position to say, you know, here are our company values and... here are the policies we promise to adhere to, and you can be quite confident that the company is going to adhere to those policies. I think your
biggest difference is that with the trustee model, the user is making explicit decisions rather than the tracking is being done in an ad hoc fashion by everyone.
That's right. So if you will, the do not track shifts the default, right? So the default now is for the companies that allow you to opt out, and that's a relatively small list of companies, opt out of tracking, I should say. Right, you have to go explicitly opt out of. You can do some at some of these NAI-like sites, or you can use some of these other tools. So there's some ways of using an intermediary, getting at multiple at the same time. And do not track would flip that. So you'd say actually no one gets to do third-party web tracking, and then you can one-off opt back in, or there could likewise be intermediaries, longer lists of sites that you opt back into at the same time. I think it's a great room for work to see how we could provide people with various sorts of trust mechanisms there. What I was going to say is my second response that I think it's very reasonable to think that if a user turns on do not track, they're just not going to opt back into a lot of stuff. It seems to me anyways that actually might be what conforms with user expectations, right? So if a user says, I don't want all these companies, variety of companies that I don't expect to interact with to learn my web browsing history, I'm not pressured to reverse that choice, some website isn't going to degrade my service, isn't going to charge me, I think there are going to be a lot of users who say, fine, like I'm going to stay opted out. And I think that's a realistic choice for industry. I mean, that's going to be part of what do not track means. Yeah.
Could Fanatic Network put up a really annoying ad flash with the big prominent thing saying, I don't want to see ads like this again, and you clicked on it? Could they take that to constitute, I want to be tracked?
So I don't want to go into that level of detail right now. The W3C is actually taking up that very question in Santa Clara next week. I would suspect kind of, sort of, no, but difficult to say. This is kind of one of those, like the old parable of like the elephant touch, right? You like, everyone kind of has their idea of how this will work, and I don't think people are not in alignment, but we're all just trying to figure this out together. So I would just hold the question, and I suspect the W3C is going to have something to say, or at least there will be some clearer divisions about where people sit on that issue. Yeah?
Is there been
much around ISP tracking? There has not been as much in the context of do not track. But you are absolutely right that there is a related privacy concern with ISP tracking. There have been some suggestions that do not track could try to address both concerns. So because ISPs can do some introspection on traffic, they could see if you're a user who has do not track turned on, at least with some high frequency. For SSL, incidentally, there was some suggestion you could add it as like an extra bit to the handshake. So there are ways in which you could try to expose it to your ISP that way. I think that's probably not a great idea. I think there are other mechanisms we could provide. So you know, your ISP, right, provides you with choices about all sorts of other things, whether it's when you sign up, whether it's some sort of mailer, you know, you name it. There are lots of design options that we can get at with an ISP that are a lot harder to get at in the context of third-party web tracking. There are also a lot of concerns about what the default's going to be there. I think in the US, it's very fair to say that do not track is not going to be enabled by default. I think it might be more reasonable to think that there might be some restrictions on what ISPs can do by default. It's just a very different political climate.
Server-side tracking. So currently, DNT is kind of a binary switch that conflates the two. I mean, is that a part of the debate, do you think, at this point, or?
So we don't see it as conflating the two. I should be clear that we're concerned about server-side tracking. We actually think like client-side tracking is totally great. In fact, there's been some great work at Microsoft Research on client-side tracking. That would be a great outcome, right? So we preserve behavioral advertising and any associated economic value, and at the same time respect user privacy, right? So that's why I think the industry self-regulation is actually totally backwards. We get rid of the thing that it looks like there might be some economic value in, and don't protect user privacy, when in fact it looks like we might have some technologies that protect user privacy while preserving that economic value. So it just seems backwards to me. So we are talking about server-side tracking. Yeah?
But all the examples here use the client-side mechanism for tracking, right?
Oh, I see what you mean by it. I should be clear, when I was saying client-side versus server-side tracking, here's what I have in mind. Server-side tracking is server builds up a list of websites the user visits. Client-side tracking, client retains the user's browsing history, and then in some very carefully controlled ways allows interaction with that history such that, for example, you can target an ad, but the server doesn't actually learn the user's full browsing history.
But aggregating analytics is much harder to do when you do it that way.
Analytics is a... Yes, so client-side analytics is tougher. Some forms of advertising analytics are doable. There are some forms of view-through tracking that you can do. Click-through tracking, I think, would be totally allowed under Do Not Track. So, you know, if you click an ad, then the ad gets to record your click. So advertising analytics, I think we have some good solutions on. In terms of site analytics, then I think you wind up in you have to start relying more on like probabilistic inferences. So if you say about half of users have Do Not Track on, I should say these are kind of broader inferences about like third-party content. You'd have to say like about half of users have Do Not Track on, but I can see the other half, and I can make some good inferences about the user population since I can still see half. But that's a relatively narrow set as best we've been able to tell. So recall that this is all about in the third-party context. So if you're a website and you want analytics in the conventional mode in which people tend to mean analytics, that wouldn't be affected by Do Not Track at all. Does that answer your question, JC? Okay, cool. So when we think about what should be a first party versus third party, our general approach is a balancing test. And usually when computer scientists hear a balancing test, they're like, what are you talking about? And policy and law people are like, oh, okay. So I am actually proposing here a policy and law type balancing test. And I think it's important to clarify where I come from and where I think a lot of my colleagues at Stanford come from on this. There are a lot of close calls in defining Do Not Track. Questions of like, what do you do about the Wall Street Journal and Fox News that are both ultimately owned by News Corp? I have an opinion on how I think that should divide out, but ultimately I have to say I really don't care. I would much rather we get a Do Not Track system that works in the 99% of cases that do actually fall into the pretty clear bucket of a social widget provider or an ad network or so on. And in that 1%, you know, if the balancing test goes the wrong way, so be it. That's the risk of standards. So we think a balancing test about user expectations is the way to go. The test around, do users reasonably expect to interact with this site. So if you're on the New York Times, you reasonably expect to interact with Google's DoubleClick ad network and share your browsing history with them. Okay, so that's it for a first-party versus third-party distinction. Now, finally, into what tracking means. So the way we've envisioned this, and this is kind of just a structural approach. I think it's a good structural approach. You could imagine going it a different way. So of course, like any sort of legal or policy rule, right, how you structure it is independent of how the substance of that rule looks in application. We think the best way to structure it is as a headline, pretty much everything is out, right? So everything is tracking. When I go make a HTTP request to Atlas to go load an ad, the information associated with the HTTP request is tracking, right? So, and then working from there, our approach is to say, what are places where we want to make some exceptions? So that's the asterisk there, right? And again, kind of apply a balancing test. But in this case, recognizing that there's a need for some more bright line rules. So, you know, there are going to be some cases where there are going to be some common business practices that we're going to want to make sure that there's no ambiguity about. But before getting into that, I want to give the motivation, the test we think about when we reason about these issues, that, you know, on the one hand, you've got your legitimate commercial interests, right? So, you know, wanting to monetize content or wanting to prevent fraud and so on, as against privacy and enforcement interests. And this may sound pretty hand-wavy, and that's kind of because it is. You know, there are going to be some cases where I think commercial interests really trump. So financial services fraud detection. I think just about everyone at the table at W3C, we certainly would agree that tracking would be okay there, that this is a sufficiently pressing problem for business, that there's a limited privacy interest in financial information, of the sort of like sign-up type stuff recognized over and over again by the courts, this wouldn't really pose a problem for enforcing do not track. So we would say that this is okay. And so that's an example of one kind of exception we would totally support. There's this challenge of bright line rules. So what do you do about the routine stuff that gets sent, stuff like protocol headers? And I think that's not easy. There's an increasing body of research that suggests that all of the stuff that we thought was totally okay, like IP addresses and user agents, and well, can't we at least keep that? It actually turns out that in a lot of cases, that can be enough to track a user.
Jonathan, you just use the word keep as opposed to use.
Yes.
And I want to ask you about that distinction.
Yes. So that is an important distinction. So I'm backing up here. Sorry, hold on. There we go. Collection, retention, and use. Distinguished, right? So one is about, do you get the data in the first place? One is about how long do you keep it? And one is about how do you use the data? You could imagine drawing arbitrary lines in any of those three categories. If your concern stems from the fact that this information exists and is in the hands of a company that you might not trust, then you probably care a lot about collection up front. That's not the approach that online advertising self-regulation has historically taken. Instead, it's focused on use. So it's focused on behavioral advertising uses of data. I think the conversation, it's fairly fair to say, is moving much more in the collection direction. The FTC has made it very clear that when it thinks about web tracking, it's thinking about collection. The European Union, likewise, has said, privacy regulatory entity within the EU has said again and again that it thinks about collection more than use.
But just to put a really fine point on it, you said it in the context of user agents and IP address,
yes,
as opposed to the things that are more obviously in this category.
So the reason I said keep instead of collect is because of the way the web works. If you want to send an ad to a web browser, you're going to get an IP address in a user agent.
Right.
And so there is a recognition that in some places, to provide some functionality, we pretty much don't have a way of doing it in a way that doesn't expose the user to the possibility of tracking.
So doesn't that move us into a retention and use conversation as opposed to a collection conversation?
It moves us to a retention and use conversation in the places where we can't avoid the collection. Yeah, so in places where, like, going to cookie a browser or do other affirmative things to do a better job of tracking, we can have a collection conversation. But right, in the space of here's a service that we think companies should continue to be able to provide, and it just happens to be a fact of life on the web that by providing that service, they're going to get some tracking information. We are going to have more of a retention and use conversation. I think there's some privacy people who aren't comfortable with that. Yeah, so there are some people who propose designs that say we should have like trusted intermediaries sitting between users and advertisers and that anonymize users. And we shouldn't actually let advertisers have user agents and IP addresses. We like to live in the world of the plausible.
I think there might be in some cases a fourth dimension to this. And if we use the example of search keywords data, you know, there may be legitimate privacy interests around use, but there's legitimate security interests around collection and some retention to be able to deal with click fraud and the like. And so that's one thing to point out is it may be these things are not discrete decisions because there may be a legitimate use that requires collection. And I think you get all that. The fourth dimension is about risk mitigation, you know, risk with the data, moving it down the scale from fully identified to de-identified to pseudonymous or whatever, you know, sliding things down there, I think, might be a fourth dimension to this whole discussion. Because different pieces of data in different states have different privacy risks associated with them.
That's absolutely right. And that was just the piece I was about to touch on, that there are requirements you can impose that do mitigate some risk. So in particular with information like IPs and user agents that are going to get collected, we have a bunch of tools in the toolbox for trying to mitigate the risk, right? Exactly, like retention periods. I think proxies are, right, again, a lot less likely to actually exist. There are various forms of crypto tools we can use. So it's a hard problem. And I would put this again in one of those places where I think you know, I have my views on how I would like the problem to be solved, but as long as we come up with a reasonable solution, I think that's great for Do Not Track. And you know, I think that mode of discussion result in getting something out of the W3C, even on these kinds of fine-grained technical issues. So I recognize I'm very short on time. This has been a great conversation. So I'm going to, if it's okay, skip to the politics stuff, reserve the economic stuff. I have a blog post on cyberlaw.stanford.edu talking about the economics. I was just going to give a sketch of that. If you're interested in the economics, you can read the blog post. So in terms of politics, there is kind of this headline question in the US of who should enforce Do Not Track. It seems pretty clear that the Federal Trade Commission is at least willing to step into that role. They're Federal Consumer Protection Agency, if you're not familiar with them. They enforce all sorts of other consumer protection laws. So I think that's an easy question. If we were to have a federal Do Not Track system, it would be the FTC. The last note I wanted to give on politics is on whether this could actually happen. Because, of course, it seems to be increasingly clear that without some sort of governmental pressure, a fully voluntary Do Not Track system that gets buy-in across the third-party tracking ecosystem is really not looking too likely. It's possible. And I sure hope the industry comes to the table and is willing to do it. But it's not looking so likely at the moment. So here are the three main playgrounds I see for getting this done in politics. At the federal level, I think it's pretty clear something's not going to happen. I wish it would. There's Senator Rockefeller has a Do Not Track bill in the Senate, Congresswoman Jackie Speier has a Do Not Track bill in the House. But the fact of the matter is the House Republicans seem really opposed to passing regulation. I think that's a shame, but the tenor of the debates seems to be actually moving less from industries doing enough to protect consumers and more of a, well, this industry is really falling flat, but we don't want to regulate the innovative internet. Yeah?
So it seems to be paradoxical that Republicans are against it because NRA is one of the biggest organizations which say you cannot have a gun registry because it allows you, government's big brother, to come onto you and, you know, isolate and understand who has guns and target them. It is all boils down to a Jew having guns in Germany at some point when Führer went after him. So if you say the story very clearly that, you know, it actually amounts to government collecting information, whether Facebook collects it and government can access it, actually goes against some of their core principles. So I'm really surprised why is the communication issue, or is it like all these guys pay enough so that it does not pass?
There are a variety of contributing factors. One is not wanting to participate in passing new regulation. One is there's been some very successful lobbying by industry. But I think you're totally right that there is an inherent tension there. And we certainly, when we've had opportunities to work with lawmakers on the Republican side, have tried to express what we see as an inconsistency between their positions on privacy and in other spaces. There are some who are definitely interested. So while I think at least right now it looks like a no on the federal side, things are unpredictable. If there's some sort of jolt, like, for example, it turns out the federal government subpoenaed Facebook like button data and used that to put someone in jail, that could be just what's necessary to get some Republican votes. So it's definitely not a stable system in no. But for now, that seems to be where it is. In the state space, or really maybe we should just say the California space, it seems to be an open-ended question. There's a bill in the California Senate right now, moved out of committee, kind of in a holding pattern, up in the air what's going to happen. The EU, though, is looking pretty good. The EU has this very strange approach to regulation, where it's kind of like this controlled loss of control, where they say, like, you know, we're going to outlaw cookies, and everyone goes, no way, you wouldn't do that. And then they say, oh, we just outlawed cookies. But we're suspending enforcement for a year. And so that's pretty much the status quo there. And EU representatives have indicated that they would see do not track as a pretty good outcome for the EU. And they mean business. That's not to say the EU will definitely do something. Again, situation very fluid. But I think it is not at all outside of the realm of possibility that we see something on do not track, or maybe something far more rigorous coming out of the EU. So that's all I wanted to say about those four topics. I was going to close with a very fast, impassioned plea to Microsoft. And that was that I think right now you guys are participating in self-regulation that's kind of a flop. At the point at which House Republicans don't think self-regulation's working, I think it's difficult to defend. And the industry associations that you guys participate in have been engaged in some pretty unsavory practices without going into specifics. And the Internet Explorer privacy features, I think, at a technological level are designed nicely, but as they're currently implemented, are really not usable by users. The tracking protection list approach, as I went into in some detail, I don't think provides users with an adequate privacy choice. And of course, there's this user interface thing. You may or may not be familiar with it, where to turn on Do Not Track, you have to install a Blink tracking protection list, which is kind of weird. So that's where your company is now. And thank you. I appreciate that.
Sometimes you, but... No, okay. Seriously, we don't tolerate that. I apologize if that's happening and you think it's coming from us.
I don't think it's coming from you, so I do want to be clear about that. But it does come from industry associations that Microsoft participates in. That is their MO.
We should have a chat about that later.
Okay. So this is my final impassioned plea. Like, please go crush your competitors on privacy. I think you guys have an awesome chance here to go whoop them. Yeah. So, like, it's very clear Google is not doing something, at least in the very near term. Facebook thinks it shouldn't even be covered by this stuff. Mozilla, I think their heart's in the right place, but they're a browser company. That's what they do. Microsoft is in a position where it does have some third-party functionality, but it also makes a very popular web browser. And so you guys are in a space to break the logjam on this. And by staking out a position on how you would support Do Not Track and enhance its implementation in Internet Explorer, I think you guys could move this debate forward an awful lot. So that's my impassioned plea, and that's all I have to say.